حي على الفلاح.
Allah, we're going to be studying the history of an amazing part of the Muslim world. A part of the Muslim world that a lot of us, unfortunately, don't know about. Maybe we've heard some things about it, but you know, our knowledge of it is very limited, and that is the history of Islam in China. I'll start giving an example of something. When I say the name Aladdin, you know, Aladdin from the cartoons and things like this, yeah. What do you usually think of? You think of the Middle East. I mean, you watch the cartoon of Aladdin, it looks like the streets of Cairo. You wouldn't know any better. How many of us realize the story of Aladdin is actually set in China? Aladdin was set in China. Aladdin is a Chinese Muslim living in China. Because you see that many parts of China, especially going towards the west of China, it's not China like you know of, you know, Beijing and, you know, all of these areas. You get to the areas where it's almost 100% Muslim. Of course, the story is nonsense. But the example that I love to give is that Aladdin was a Chinese Muslim. This is something that, you know, flies over most people's heads. And if you read the story of Aladdin, in the first few sentences, it says Aladdin was in China. So this is something to introduce that, yes, there are Muslims in China. They play a great part in the history of the Ummah, but they've been largely forgotten, unfortunately. Now, when we look at the spread of Islam, as we know, we've mentioned, you know, Islam spread throughout the Middle East, from Mecca, going, you know, in all directions. And Islam spread through what we call the Silk Road. The Silk Road is basically the way between the Middle East and China, you know, the Central Asian states. Now, from the very beginning of Islam, we're talking at the time of Uthman, radiallahu anhu. He sent an envoy to China. So he sent a group of Muslims to China. And one of the people he sent was the Sahabi Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, radiallahu anhu. So Sa'ad, he actually visited China. He was an envoy on behalf of Uthman. And it said that his father actually came with him. So Abi Waqqas, his father, came, and he's actually buried in China. And there was a masjid that was built, because when the Chinese emperor received them, he was so proud, you know, to have a relation with the Muslim empire, that he built a masjid in their honor. He built the masjid of the Huaxiang Mosque. Huaxiang, it actually means like a memorial mosque. And the reason why he did this, the Chinese emperor, was to honor the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was actually erected in the memory of the Prophet. So he said, this empire that was started by him, the relations that we have, I want to build a masjid on your behalf. And at the Huaxiang Mosque, it said that the father of Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, Abu Waqqas himself, is actually buried there. Subhanallah. Well, what happened as we're looking, you know, the Prophet, Uthman, he sent his envoy. So Muslims were visiting China very early on. You know, they were going there for trades. The Chinese wanted to trade with the Muslims. The Muslims wanted to trade with the Chinese. So you had this relationship going on of traders going through, and actually became established in here. Now, you see that from where Sa'ad actually visited, there was a city called Guangzhou. Later on became known as Canton. It is one of the largest cities in the world up until now, and even at the time, it was one of the largest cities in the world. China's a very big country. But no doubt, you know, trade up until today, you know, trade is a large part of the Chinese culture, and we're going to sort of elaborate on this a little bit later, how the trade relationship between the Muslims and China continues until today. So we saw at this time, you know, very early on, we're talking in the year 616 this happens. It's not long after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Guangzhou had four mosques, four very big mosques that were built in this early stage. And as we said, you know, you had the father of Sa'ad that was visited, buried there. Now, going on later, you know, the Muslims didn't really influence Da'wah very strong. You know, for the next 300-400 years, there were only very small steps made. It wasn't really till the year 1000 when a new dynasty took over. It was called the Song Dynasty. Now, once the Song Dynasty came into power, they actually put a Muslim in charge of all of their trade affairs. Like, you know how you've got a trade minister who looks after all of the trade? It was actually a Muslim. That, you know, the office of the director of the general of shipping was always held by a Muslim. The law of the dynasty said that a Muslim must hold this, because the Muslims were the key to trade. Yeah, they were trustworthy, but they were also a key. And the Chinese saw this. The Chinese saw that using the Muslims, you know, it would benefit themselves and it would benefit the Muslims. And you saw they had a respect for Islam. you know, the emperor would build a masjid. No, generally you find most of the emperors, they didn't really have any issues. They had very, very good relationship with the Muslims. And from the beginning, you definitely saw most of the emperors welcome the Muslims. I mean, during the Song Dynasty, you know, the emperor at this time, he actually invited 5,500 Muslims from Bukhara. Bukhara is in Central Asia, we know from Imam Bukhari. He came from Bukhara. The emperor, he actually invited 5,500 Muslims to settle just north of Beijing. The reason why he wanted them to come to Beijing is because he knew the Muslims were very noble warriors. You know, like many of the Chinese at the time, you know, as you see, the dynasties are changing. You got the Ming Dynasty, you got the Song Dynasty, the Qing. It's changing very quickly. Most of the Chinese, they might not always remain loyal. But he saw the Muslims, on the other hand, were very, you know, noble warriors. What he did is because just north of Beijing, so sort of going closer towards the Korean Peninsula, you had an empire that was known as the Liao Empire. And the Liao Empire was threatening the Song Dynasty. So rather than putting Chinese, you know, his own brethren, Han Chinese, in power, he invited these Muslims from Bukhara. Because he said they're going to do a better job than what the Chinese would do defending my land. So he invited these Muslims. Now they were actually led by an emir, and his name was Amir. But you see, Prince Amir, he actually took on a Chinese name as well. So the people, they knew him as Sol Fei Er. Sol Fei Er, this was his Chinese name. Otherwise, the Muslims in Arabic, they knew him as Amir. Now, because he was one of the first Muslims to really establish themselves with a great respect, they were invited by the emperor. These are people who, you know, were very close to the heart of the emperor. They actually, the Muslims in China today, they call him the father of Islam. Because really, I mean, before you had people trading, going in and out, but he's the first one who really settled in China. And he didn't just settle in China, he was invited by the emperor and had a great respect for the emperor and actually protected them. So that even the Chinese will respect this man. And of course, the Chinese Muslims, out of respect for this, you know, they call him the father of Islam in China. And you see, at this time, in the Chinese language, they actually used to call Islam Da Shifa. Da Shifa, it means the law of the Arabs. Now, what happened was the Amir, what he actually did, Prince Amir, he said, this name is not suitable. You have to say the law of the Arabs, because as we said at the start, the majority of the Muslims that the dynasty knew were the Arabs that were trading with them. So he said, you know, their religion is the law of the Arabs. But now you got Muslims from Bukhara. You got Muslims coming. They're not Arabs. They're from Central Asia. Yeah, closely related to the Persians. Then we're not Arabs. So what happened was when they actually mixed in with the Chinese people, they became known as the Hui. Because in China, you've got many groups. The largest group, usually what we call Chinese, they're called the Han. The Han are like the normal Chinese looking people that you've got. You've got a few other groups. The Han are the majority. Now the Muslims, they mixed with the Han and they became known as the Hui. So the religion of Islam, the name was actually changed. Amir, he said to the emperor, change the name from Da Shifa to Hui Hui Jiao, which means the religion of the Hui. And Hui, by default, it meant the Muslims. So you see, the emperor said no problem. So from that point onwards, you know, you had to refer to Muslims as Hui. You couldn't refer to them as Arabs.